HDL and the input will start at very low. So my screen is visible to all of you, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So today we'll learn about the VHDL, hardware description language. So as we know, this V stands for VHSIC, hardware description language. So it is a very high speed integrated circuit hardware description language. So it is used to describe digital hardware for the integrated circuit for a VLSI technology integrated circuit. Okay. So let me start first So VHDL is a case insensitive language. Case insensitive language. First thing about the VHDL is case insensitive language. So if you write the entity like this word, or you write the entity using all the letter in a small, or you can write the entity all the letters are capital, VHDL understand every word it's equal, because VHDL is a case insensitive language. Right. Second thing, to give the comment for the comment line, it is to double dash. Whatever we'll write after the double dash, take as a comment line. Comment line. Okay. Now let try to understand by writing one simple VHDL program. We'll understand the structure of VHDL. So let's take one example, one digital system, and that will write. Suppose I have one AND gate, and the output of AND gate, it is OR with the an OR gate, and this is my output, and these are the my input. Suppose if you want to implement inside the chip this functionality where I want to AND A and B, I want to AND A and B, so and ending of A and B, 1, 2 OR with C, and that is my output that I want. So it is equal to A and B plus C. So suppose if you want to implement this functionality inside the chip using the hardware description language VHDL. So first of all, we have to see how many port coming out from the this chip. So here there are 4 port. One is for the input A, and this port we want to use as an input. Means we want to read the data from the line A. Similarly, port B, and port B also we want to use this port as an input. So the chip will read the data from this port. And port C also we want to use as an input, and port Y we want to use as an output. and the inside the IC we want to implement this architecture. So let's see how to write its VHDL program. So in a VHDL program, structure is first of all, it's have a library and the package declaration. Second part in a VHDL program, it is the entity declaration. And third part, it is a architecture body. So any VHDL program, it divide in three part: library packet declaration, entity declaration, and the architecture body. So let me write the VHDL program of this design. So first of all, we have to declare the library and the package. So for that, library and packet declaration. So for the library and packet declaration, library name of library space and then the name of library. So here we need to include the library. In a Verilog, it is inbuilt, not needed to include any library in package. It use all the inbuilt library. Now from this library IEEE, if you want to use specific package, right? So library IEEE is like a big library, and from this library, which cupboard, if you take the example in our college library, so it is like our library, and in the library, which cupboard we want to use, want to access, right? So that is nothing but the package. So inside the library, there have many packages is defined. So here we want to implement some logic functionality. Here we want to do the ending and ORing. So for that, package is st_logic. It have a, inside that package return the function of all the logic. So we can directly call them, right? If we write AND, then it is called that AND function, and inside that is written to perform a ending operations. So that AND, OR, all are the function names, the predefined. So that function is returned inside the package. So syntax for that is use space name of library. So here the name of library is IEEE. From this library, which package we want to access? So we want to access a package inside which some for the logic function are defined. So inside this std_logic_1164, all the logic are defined, right? Dot all. So here also we can specify inside this package which particular function we want to use. So if we write dot all, so it allow to access all the functions. So this is the part of a library and packet declarations. Second part is a entity declarations, right? So in entity declaration is whatever the coming outside from the chip. So this is in a Verilog it is called a module, but in VHDL it is called an entity. This is one entity, right? So that is whatever the input and output port that are declared in an entity. So an entity is a block name, right? So here you can write entity, then the name of entity. Now in a name of entity, name of entity, it should not be a reserved keyword. First thing is, you have to remember when we give the name of entities, it should not, we cannot use a reserved keyword like entity, library, use, AND, or are, or also the functions of VHDL. We cannot use that for to give the name of entity, right? And another thing is, when we specify the name of entity, you have to remember, entity must be, name of entity must be a single word. Suppose if you are writing the half header entity, and for better to read or to know about the VHDL program, we are normally writing the half header, but we have to write half underscore header like that, or we have to combine half and header both the word into a single word. Third thing, the name of entity should not start with the number. It must always, we have to start with the alphabet. Later on, we can write the number. Suppose I want to write AN2 or AN3, AND3 like that. So we can write the number later on, but should not start with the number. We cannot write like 3 AND, 4 AND like that. So here the name of entity, we have to specify. Let's we specify the name of entity is TAV, testing and verification is. So this is the name of entity. Now here the sentence is not complete. It is entity TAV is, so it is sentence is not completed. So there is no any semicolon, right? Then the pod. So inside the pod, we have to declare what are the pins coming out from this chip. That can the external world can see for the interface purpose. So we have to define that the chip, the port coming out from the this module. So here there are three ports. A, B, and C are the port in mode, and the type is, we can define as a bit, as well as there are two options in VHDL. We can define type is bit, as well as we can define type is STD and SQL logic. Let me, later on I will tell you what is the difference between a bit and the STD and SQL logic. So here, all the three pins A, B, and C have a same mode and same type, so we can define the commonly we can define. So A, comma B, comma C, type is in. So this mode is in, and type is, let's say, STD and SQL logic. Semicomma, then the remaining is Y. Now the Y is, the mode of Y is, we want to use this port as an output port. So the defined as mode is out, and the type is STD underscore logic. Then here, once we complete all declaration of all the port, after the small bracket, give the semicolon. Then the end entity. We can here write the end entity, or also we can write the end entity name. Both the syntax is valid in a VHDL. We can write the end TAV or end entity. Okay, semicolon. So this is the declaration of entity. So in entity, just you have to remember, we have to declare the port list which are the coming out from this module, coming out from this this chip. That this port we have to declare inside the entity, and you have to remember the rules when you give the name of entity. So that's about the entity. Next is the architecture body. Any questions in this? Library packet declaration and the entity declaration. No any questions.
So sir, STD had to underscore logic came like we know already. Input output port.
Yes, let me, I will explain you what is the STD underscore logic. Before that, let me first complete the with the architecture body, so you can understand what is actual structure of VHDL program. Then we'll differentiate what is bit two types, bit and the STD underscore logic. Okay. So last part is the architecture body. So in architecture body, we have to describe what is inside the module. So here, whatever the inside the module that we have to describe in a architecture body. So this is architecture inside view, right? Whatever we want to implement. So this is inside view. So that we have to describe the in architecture body. Now in a VHDL, it support. We can write the architecture using three different style. One is we can write using a data flow as similar as in a Verilog also have the data flow. Another way we can write the architecture modeling, it is a structural architecture modeling. This is also in a Verilog, structural architecture modeling. Right. And third architecture modeling style is behavior architecture modeling. Behavioral architecture model. So in VHDL we can write the architecture either using data flow architecture modeling or structural architecture modeling or behavioral architecture modeling. So in a data flow architecture modeling, it is easy when to write when we know the data flow from one register to another register. If we know the data flow of our design, right? It means if our design is ready in terms of the Boolean equations, if our design is ready in terms of Boolean equations. Right, y is equal to a into b plus c. So it is one of Boolean equations. So if our design in terms of Boolean equation, then to use the data flow is very easy to describe the hardware, to describe the Boolean equation in a VHDL. Another is structural architecture modeling. So this structural architecture modeling actually used for the hierarchy types of design. Suppose if we are designing from 1-bit full adder to the 4-bit full adder. So we can call the 1-bit full adder and we can construct the 4-bit full adder. And similarly for suppose we want to implement a 4-bit ripple carry counter. So we know that the counter can be implemented using the T flip-flops. So we can call the module of the T flip-flops, and by connecting the T flip-flop we can construct a 4-bit ripple carry counter, right? So structural architecture is easy to model a complex design from the simple available module. So just we have to in a structural architecture modeling, just we have to write a programming to show how the different module are we have to connect, right? So just we have to show the connection of different module in the structural architecture model. Third is the behavioral architecture model. So if our design is not ready in a form of Boolean equations, we do not directly say this is the Boolean equation of my logic or of my from the specification, or even our design is not have some similar block, so we can use that block and we can construct the complex design. But the design in form of some specification statement, and that can be implemented some algorithms or some like in when we are writing the C programming. Similarly, it's have a supporting also in a VHDL. We can write the program in some algorithmic form. We can use some branching. We can use some conditional statement. Sorry, not branching, but so we can use some conditional statement if, nested if, case, for loop, right? So that we can use in a behavior architecture modeling. Okay? And all the sequential design where we need to first check clock edge and all the D flip flops or all the reg block it triggered at the clock edge, right? So first of all, we have to check clock edge is arrived or not. So in that is possible in a behavior architecture modeling, because in a data flow and the structural architecture modeling, all the statements run concurrently. All the statements run concurrently, right? That means all the statements run parallel. So if I write some statement and all the statements run parallelly, I can't check the conditions, right? Based on conditions, suppose I want to skip some statement to execute and want to execute another set of statement. So it's not possible when all the statements run concurrently. It is possible only when if the that run in a sequentially. So it's possible in a behavioral architecture modeling. So in behavior architecture modeling, whatever we write, it's have one process statement. So whatever we write to define the process, the process begin to the process end, whatever we write in between the statement, that all the statement run the sequentially one by one. So it run first statement and then second statement. So in that case, we can use some conditional statement. Suppose if you want to use if, right? If this logic, if some condition, if its condition is true, I want to run some set of statements. And if the condition is false, we want to run another set of statement. So it is possible when the program or when all the statement run sequentially, it execute in a sequence. So it have in a VHDL have the process statement. Similar in a Verilog have the always statement. Right? So in a process, whatever right between the begin and end of the process, all the statement run sequentially. Okay? So there are three types of architecture modeling in a VHDL: data flow, structural, and behavioral. In a Verilog, it's a one more extra architecture modeling. It is switch level architecture modeling. Right? So where we can implement a design using a device rather than start with the logic gate. So it is some lower level architecture modeling. One step lower is have provided in a Verilog. So in VHDL have only the three types of architecture modeling. So here our design is, we want to implement the end and then we want to OR it, right? And here, this is the design which we want to implement, right? So first thing is architecture, how to write the architecture body. So architecture syntax is, first we have to write the architecture. Architecture, then we have to specify the name of architecture. Here you can specify any name, or also you can specify the name of entity, right? That also it will be defined, it not give you any error. Or you can specify the any name of architecture. So here it is a name of architecture we have to specify. Of this architecture is for which entity? So in a single entity may have more than one architecture. Single entity have more than one architecture. So this architecture for which entity? So suppose this is for the TAV entity. Name of our entity is a TAV, right? Is. So this sentence is also not completed. So there is no any semicolon. Otherwise, most of line in a VHDL end with semicolon, right? But here it is incomplete line. After the architecture, now, depending on the type of architecture modeling, suppose if you are writing using the data flow architecture modeling, then in data flow, after the architecture, we have to specify any signal we want to use, intermediate connections. So here we have a one intermediate connection, right? this is our one intermediate connection. Ending of A and B that we want to give to the that for the O-ring with C. So here this is our one intermediate signal. Let me call this name as S. Right? So this is the space in a program where we can declare any signal or variable. There are two types. One is the signal and another is a variable. We can declare that jumper wire as a signal or as a variable. Variable data types, signal data type and variable data. Now difference between signal and the variable is, signal is store and forward the data. It store and forward the data. And variable is only forward the data. So it is simply a jumpering wire. And the signal is a wire plus D flip-flop. So it can hold the data. It can hold the data. Suppose if you want to hold the data up to the next clock edge, so signal can hold the data, variable. Then the signal, it can change only one times in a one process statement. Suppose this process statement is executed, and here we have assigned something to the signal, and here also we have assigned some new value to the signal. It cannot, we cannot assign the two times in a single process. When we have this process statement is done, we cannot assign in a single process two times, or we cannot change the signal value multiple times in a single process. Right? So signal can change only one times in a one process. But the variable we can change the multiple times in a single process. Right. So that the base difference between the signal and variable as a intermediate connection or the jumper. So here we can declare as a signal or the variable. So signal, syntax is signal, then the name of signal whatever we want to give. So here I want to give the name of signal is S, and the there is no any mode. Signal is input and output, right? It is a bidirectional input and output. So it we not need to specify the mode, directly the type of signal. So here also it is an std underscore logic. So we can transfer signal to the input and output variable, because all the input port, output port and signal have same type, then we can transfer the data. If it's a different type, then it will give the error when we transfer the data. Then we, here we are writing using the data flow. So the next statement is begin, and bit after the begin and before the end architecture, we have to specify the architecture of the design. So here our architecture is, we want to transfer in S, we want to transfer ending of A and B. So here we write A, A and D. So A and D is one of the function name, and this function is written inside the std underscore logic underscore 1164 package. So it will call this function and then check what the functionality have to do. So this inside the end is written to perform a ending operation of A and B, bitwise ending operations. Save it. Then the our output Y. So output Y is equal to S or C. So here you can see we can use S on the left hand side as well as on the right hand side, because S is the signal. So we can read the data from the signal, we can write the data on the signal. And we have a defined A, B and C are the input mode. So we cannot write that, we cannot write the A and B, C on the left hand side. We cannot assign the data, assign any signal to A and B. We can read the data from that port only, so it is on the right hand side. And why we have declared as an output, so it's always on the left hand side. We can assign the data onto that port, we cannot read the data from that port. Okay. So this is once the architecture declaration is complete, then the end architecture or end architecture name. So here the architecture name we have specified, it is architecture underscore name and then the semicolon. So this is a program structure of VHDL. So now the question was about the what is the STD underscore logic and what is a bit. So we can declare either as a bit type or STD underscore logic type. So let so one is bit and another is STD underscore logic. So when we define as a bit, it can understand only the two logic. One is a logic 0 and another is a logic 1. And when we define as a type is STD underscore logic, it can understand different 9 logic. One is the strong 0, strong 1. I will define what is strong 0, strong 1. Similarly, the weak 0, weak 1 and the undefined, then the high impedance state. So there are different 9 logic it can understand once we define as a STD underscore logic. And bit is understand only the strong 0 and strong 1. Strong 0 and the strong 1. Okay. Now strong 0 is, as we have discussed in a CMOS inverter, CMOS inverter give us a strong 0 as well as a strong 1. Because in a CMOS invert, or if you see, the NMOS is pass the strong 0 but a weak 1, and PMOS is pass a strong it pass a strong 0 but weak 1. So if you combine the NMOS and PMOS, it will give us the strong 1 and the strong 0, right? So strong 1 means it is strong 0 means it is a fully it is, suppose our logic level is between logic 0 voltage is 0 and logic 1 voltage is suppose 5 volt, then the strong 0, that means exactly a 0 volt. Strong 1 means a 5 volt. Weak 0 means if not a exactly 0 volt, it's a greater than 0 by a 1 threshold drop of a MOSFET. So it is somewhere here, it is V1. So it is V1 which is a greater than the 0 volt, if not a exact 0 volt. Weak 1, it is not exactly a 5 volt, which is a 1 threshold voltage drop compared to 5 volt. So it is an VY which is a less than the 5 volt, less than or equal to 5. So if it's VY is equal to 0, then it is called a strong 0. Right, and VY is greater than that 0, then it's called a weak 0. Undefined is, it may be output is logic 0 or logic 1. It is undefined. and the high impedance net, that means this net, it not connected with the VDD, as well as this net is also not connected with the ground. So it is an hanging wire. It is called a high impedance net, because if you see, if we measure the impedance for this wire, it not connected with the VDD as well as the ground, so it provide the high impedance. That's why that such types of wire which is not connected to VDD or ground, it is called a high impedance net in a digital design. Okay. So is it clear now difference between a bit and the SDD and score logic?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, now let me write the same program using the structural architecture modeling. Right? So let me write the same using the structural architecture modeling. We have written using the data flow architecture modeling. Now in a structural architecture modeling, suppose we have a ready two input AND gate, which we already have designed, right? And also we have a ready one two input OR gate. Both the program we already have a written, right? Here it is a simple two input AND and two input OR, but in actual design, it is some module and it is already designed by someone else. So why we are wasting the time to design that already designed module, right? So why we cannot use that ready-made module? And if you can arrange the different ready-made module, and if you can construct some useful digital system, or it can give the functionality as per our specification, then we can use that module using the structural architecture modeling. So let's say we have a ready one module which is called a AND_2 and the OR_2. These two module means this program of AND and program of OR_2 is ready with us, right? So it is written somewhere. It is ready with us, and the name of input are, let's say, X, Y, and Z. Are the input and output of AND_2, and P, Q, and R are the input output of the OR gate, right? That we have a given in the entity of AND_2 module and the OR_2 component, right? Here in a VHDL it is called a component, in a Verilog it's called a module. So how we can call that component? So let we are writing the program for this design, this our design, right? Using structural architecture modeling. So again, we have to declare the library. So library IEEE. Then from this library, which package we want to use? So from this library, we want to use std_logic_116 name package dot all. Then the entity. So here in entity, what we have to write? So here entity, here the input and output of this module is A, B, and C, and Y is output. So inside the entity, let's say this entity of TAB is port A, B, C are the input mode. std_logic. VHDL support, there are three types of mode VHDL can support, right? Three types of mode. One is the input mode, one is the output mode, and one is the in-out mode. Four types of mode is support: input mode, output mode, in-out mode, and buffer mode. Right? Buffer mode. So input mode is clearly understood. Once we define any port as an input, then we can read the data from that port. We cannot write the data on that port. It is very clearly we can understood very easily, self understood. And output, similarly, once we define any port as an output, suppose here we have defined Y as an output, so we can write the data on that port. We can assign some signal on that port. We cannot read the signal from that port. So that is output. In out is we can write as well as we can write it is a bi-directional port. And buffer is something like is internally we can read and externally we can write. Suppose here have a I have a some NAND gate that I want to use as an output. Suppose this is my Q out, and that Q out I also want to use internally to the input of my another NAND gate, right? So I need to define this Q as an buffer. So once I define as a buffer, then and then it allow to use internally input. If I define Q as only the output, then it will give the error. Once I read this, when I take this Q to the input of another NAND gate, then it, at that time it give you error. Right. So here it is an externally output for external word. External means outside this module. For outside this module, this Q work as an output port, right? And this is work as an input port for another device. And here internally, it also provide the facility. Internally, we can use Q as an input. So we cannot this internally we can use as input and output externally only the output. So that is a buffer mode. Right? So there are three types of mode support in the VHDL. Y is the output. So out std underscore logic. Right. Then the right and. And entity, so and TAV or entity name we can write. Now next part is the architecture. So architecture, here we want to write the architecture using structural architecture modeling. So architecture, any name of architecture we can give of this architecture for which entity. So it is for the TAV entity. Now after the architecture, this is the space where we need to declare the component. Whatever the component we want to use in this design using structural design, that component we have to declare the after the architecture. So this is the space where we have to declare the component. So here we want to use two component. One is the AND underscore 2 and another is OR underscore 2. These are the two program we already written, and for that program name we have a means the name of program must be same as the name of entity, right? That is the in a VHDL requirement. So it is VHDL condition. So whatever the name of entity, we have to keep the file name must be same as the entity name. So this is the end underscore two. It is an entity name of the end two input end gate. So here we have to declare the component. So how to declare the component? We have to copy the entity portion from the entity to the end entity, entity portion of the end underscore two program, right? So suppose and we have to replace the entity with component. So what would be the entity of end underscore two program is? So here the component, sorry. Yes. Component, then the here it is the name of entity, right? So name of entity is AND underscore 2 is and port list of that entity. So in the port list you can see here we have a given AX, Y and Z are the input output of the, so AX and Y are the input std underscore logic and Z is the output of two input AND gate, right? So std underscore logic and the AND component. So this is one component AND underscore 2. Similarly, we want another component which is a OR underscore 2. Let me I need to write in second place. So second component is OR underscore 2. Component OR underscore 2 is port of that OR underscore 2. We have given the name of that port in entity of OR underscore 2 is PQRD input. And the PQR, R is the output. And component, and this component. After the component declaration, space is to declare the intermediate. So here we want to give the output of AN2 to the one of the input of OR underscore 2. So let me call this as a signal S. So let me declare the signal S here. So here it is a signal S and only the type std underscore logic. After that begin, and after the begin and between the end architecture in structural architecture modeling, we have to just describe the how the different component are connected, right? So here any label we can specify, and the port component port map of AND underscore 2. Now we have to provide here the mapping, port map of AND underscore 2, right? So that is where we want to connect. So here let me see where we want to connect this X. X we want to connect with A, right? And Y we want to connect with B, right? So we have to specify X to A, Y to B, and the Z to S. So that is the port connection. There are two types of port connection, position mapping and the name mapping. So name mapping is recommended where the design have a many ports, so it is very easy to identify. So X we want to connect with A, Y we want to connect with B, and the Z we want to connect with S. And for similarly for another component which is OR underscore 2, in OR underscore 2 P we want to connect with S, Q we want to connect with external input C, and the R that is our external output Y. And the end architecture. So this is implementation using structural architecture modeling. Any questions in this? So this is the program how we can implement design using structural architecture modeling. So the syntax is same for any design. Here we have implemented this example for if you are writing for any another design, the programming style is same. Last one, it is a behavioral architecture model. In a behavioral architecture modeling, here the library and the entity part is as it is, library and entity part. Only change in architecture body, because all are the architecture modeling style. So there would not be any change in the entity in libraries. Architecture, name of architecture, right? Then here the space to declare any signal, same as in a data flow. STD underscore logic. Now here the difference is here have the process statement, right? Then begin, then after the begin have the process statement. So inside the process we have to declare a sensitivity list. So normally in a sensitivity list or input inside the sensitivity list, right? So this is called as sensitivity list. Okay. So this define when we want to run the program. So whenever having any event, any one of the sensitivity list, it run the statement written between after begin and end process on a sequence, sequential, right? So if having any event, event means the A is going to change from logic 0 to 1 or 1 to 0. So it is called an event in the signal. So here we want to implement, we want to transfer in S, it is a ending of A and B, and in Y, it is S pouring with C. And end process and end architecture, whatever the name of architecture. So this is, so here whatever you write after the begin and end process, this statement run the sequential. And when it run, whenever having any event in a sensitivity list. So whenever having event in a sensitivity list, then it execute the statement written between and begin and end process. Okay, is it clear? Any questions? So in a behavioral architecture modeling, up to this is same. So here you can see up to this is same in all the architecture modeling program. After the begin, in a behavioral architecture modeling have the process statement. So in a behavior architecture modeling, architecture may have more than one process statement. And each process statement itself is a concurrent statement, right? So all the process run the parallel. But whatever we write inside the process statement, between after the begin and before the end process, all the statement run sequentially, one by one. First it execute the statement, and then it execute the statement. Right, and when it run the program, so it will run the program whenever having any event in a sensitivity list. So here we have defined the A, B, and C. So there having any change in A, B, and C, then it execute the program. And we want whenever having the change in A, B, and C, then and then output will going to change. Otherwise, output will be the as it is the previous output. Right, so not need to be run continuously. So this program is run only when any event occur in the sensitivity list. So here if you write as a sensitivity list only the A variable, A port A, and if you not declared the B and C, right? So whenever having the change in B and C, or C, the program will not execute and the output will be the as it is the previous output. So there will be no any effect of B and C in the output. And whenever having any event in A, then and then it calculate the new output, right? So normally in a sensitivity list, it all the input, because output we want, output is going to change only when the input is going to change. And in a sequential design, sensitivity list is normally a clock, because whenever any clock triggering, clock positive or negative is depending on that design, then and then our output is going to trigger, right? So inside the sensitivity list, it is a clock. Hope it is cleared now.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So any questions? We have discussed the generalized structure of VHDL program with all the three architecture models. Any questions? I have one question. In a data flow architecture modeling, as I told, in a behavioral architecture modeling, whenever having any event in a sensitivity list, then the program is going to execute whatever written between the begin and end process. But what about the data flow architecture modeling? So there is no any process statement. So when this program will execute, it continuously execute the program, there is no any clock like that, right? So when it execute the program?
Can anyone else want to answer?
Sir, it run in continuous statement. When the any variable change, then the value of our output change.
It not run continuously. It whenever having any event in a input variable or the left hand side variable. So whenever having event in A, B, C, right, then it run the statement. So here suppose any event in A, then it calculate the new output of S. Now S is going to change, so again it run the second statement. If the S is not going to change, then it not run the second statement. So it is run whenever having the event on the left hand side, right hand side variable. Okay, is it clear? Also, in a VHDL architecture may have the combination of structural data flow and behavior. Also, it is in a combination of some portion we can write using the structural, and some also we can write using the data flow in a single architecture body. So it may have the combination of two types of architecture modeling, or all the three types of architecture modeling. Is it clear? Any questions? Okay, so we have started the lecture with VHDL in its structure, and we have written how to write. We have learned how to write a VHDL program using the different architecture modeling, and when to use which types of architecture modeling.